Thank you, David. I very much appreciate you being invited here to speak tonight. Can you all hear me okay? I very much appreciate the efforts of Americans for Prosperity, and I'm quite honored to be asked by them to speak today. And I'm also honored to be in the company of some very knowledgeable speakers on this topic who are very eloquent and love this country. And I'm also honored to be in your presence because I know that you care about this issue and you love our country as well. So I'm very pleased that you're here this afternoon. A couple of words about myself. My name is Mark Neerhof. I'm an obstetrician. I practice high-risk OB, which means that I take care of moms with medical and obstetric complications of their pregnancy. I practice at North Shore University Health System in Evanston, Illinois. I'm also an associate, a clinical associate professor of obstetrics and gynecology at the University of Chicago Pittsburgh School of Medicine. And as David mentioned, I'm an executive board member of an organization, it's a grassroots organization called Docs for Patient Care. That's an organization of 4,000 physicians across the country who are dedicated primarily to maintaining the doctor-patient relationship. And as a result, we are opposed to Obamacare. So those are my credentials. Now let me tell you who I really am. I'm a kid from Sheboygan, Wisconsin. I grew up with a very humble background. My father had an eighth grade education. My mother finished high school. I can only hope to be half the man that my father was. He fought in the invasions of Saipan and then in Okinawa. He was one of a unit of 250 men that went into Okinawa. He was one of 26 of those men that came out alive. And he was on a stretcher. He spent the next year in a hospital, had multiple surgical procedures. And just toward the end of that year, as he was preparing to marry my mother, they were told that as a result of his multiple surgeries and his injuries, that they should not expect to have any children. Well, I'm their fourth. So I guess that just goes to show you what those doctors know. I will never forget coming home from college, Thanksgiving break of my freshman year. I sat down across the kitchen table from my parents and I told them that I decided I want to go to medical school. And they laughed. It's not because they didn't think I was able to do it. It's because they never imagined that a child of theirs would have the opportunity to go into medicine. And here I am, 30-some years later. I am very, very proud to be part of the best healthcare system in the world. And I also consider myself very blessed to live in the greatest country this world has ever seen. I'd like to talk with you a little while today about Obamacare and my concerns about Obamacare as a physician. I care for patients every day, and my primary focus is doing what's right for my patient, and in that context, maintaining the doctor-patient relationship. Obamacare is going to compromise the doctor-patient relationship. How is it going to do that? Let me give you a couple of examples. I can tell you something that's already in place. There's a program that's called Meaningful Use. I call it meaningless abuse, but they call it meaningful use. And what that means is that for any healthcare system that is seeing patients who have Medicare, and if they're using an electronic medical record, when you see a patient, each time you need to go down a little checklist of things that you need to review. For example, the checkoff allergies review, problem list review, whether or not they smoke review. Now, there's some value in reviewing each of those things. But the way that the federal government is using this is that for the first 2 years of this program, if you comply with checking all the little boxes, then you get some extra reimbursement from the federal government. But after 2 years, that carrot turns into a stick. And if you don't check off the little boxes, they will decrease the amount of compensation that your healthcare system gets from Medicare. And soon, that's going to apply to all of medicine, at least for all of the insurance programs that come through the health insurance exchanges through Obamacare. Now, again, there's some value in doing those things, but at the same time, I'm very opposed to a bureaucrat in Washington who doesn't have any medical training determining what I should be doing and reviewing when I see patients in my office. And secondly, if you think it's going to be listed or limited to the things I just listed for you, you're kidding. Because pretty soon, if I don't prescribe the right medication, right according to them, or if I prescribe or ask for an extra test or whatever, we as a healthcare system are going to have our reimbursement reduced. That's our decision, what medication you get, and what tests you need, what you should get. That's not a bureaucrat's decision to make, and that's not their role to interfere with those decisions. Secondly, you've all heard of the Independent Payment Advisory Board. That is going to be a board of 15 unelected, unaccountable bureaucrats whose job is to control the increase in costs of healthcare. And they in fact need to cut the increase in costs by 50%. Here's something that you probably don't know. The only way that they can cut costs, the only way that they're capable of cutting costs, is number one, to decrease the reimbursement to physicians, and number two, to limit the number of procedures that can be performed. What that means is that when you come into your doctor and you're 65 years old and you need a hip replacement, the Independent Payment Advisory Board can decide, you know what, we can meet these costs by just not giving people 65 and older hip replacements. Or 60 years and older, you don't get a bypass surgery anymore. Or whatever. And whatever they say is law. It can't be, effectively, it cannot be challenged. That's not America. You and I should be making those decisions, not a panel of bureaucrats in Washington. You're all familiar with the decision that was reached by the U.S. Preventative Task Force some years ago, that women under 40 should not be able to get a mammogram. And they also decided in their infinite wisdom that men really don't need PSAs. I don't know, I could introduce you to several women who were diagnosed with breast cancer before the age of 40. And they're alive today because some physician sat down and said, you know what? Because of your family history, you should get this. Under Obamacare, that wouldn't happen. Because not only would that not be reimbursable, that physician would be penalized for ordering a mammogram on a woman under 40. that's compromising the care of the patients that I care for. That's why I'm primarily why I'm here today. I don't want that to happen. That's my primary focus as a physician. And that's going to affect patients, particularly patients at the extremes of life. Folks who are older, we have more healthcare requirements and costs, and the little premature babies that I deliver. That's where most of the expenses, those are the people who are going to be cut off from care. Let's talk for a few moments about Medicaid. Medicaid is the worst health insurance program in the country. Obamacare insured roughly 32 million new people. It insured them by placing 16 of those 32 million people on Medicaid, by dramatically expanding Medicaid coverage. I care for a lot of patients on Medicaid because we take care of moms who are in trouble and we don't say no to anybody. But I can tell you that Medicaid reimbursement is horrible. I can do that because Medicaid is only a quarter to a third of the patients that I care for. But if that was a much larger percentage or proportion, in the end, I do run a business. I employ a lot of ultrasound technicians. We buy expensive ultrasound machines. We employ a lot of nurses. I do run a business, and I can't run that business losing money. And if they continue to expand Medicaid, I can't run a business with Medicaid patients, or at least a large proportion of them. And you're probably thinking, well, didn't the Supreme Court decide that we don't need to dramatically expand Medicaid? The answer is yes. Thank God they did decide that. But think about that for a moment. I just told you that half of the additional people who are going to be insured were simply placed on Medicaid. What were the primary two goals of Obamacare? Number one was universal coverage. Number two was to control costs, decrease costs. Even if Obamacare was fully implemented as it was supposed to be, by the end of this decade, there would be 10 million uninsured people. Now, if you add that 16 million who are not, after all, going to be insured, we have as many or more uninsured people as we did to begin with. So primary goal number one, universal coverage, is a failure. Controlling costs. If any of you believe that Obamacare is going to control costs, even after the CBO said that after a year, the estimated 10-year cost went from 900-some billion to 1.8 trillion. If you really believe that this is going to control costs, you should go directly home and take your medication. So on both of the primary goals of Obamacare, it's a failure. Medicare is coverage for seniors. A lot of physicians no longer can afford to care for Medicare patients. For example, the Mayo Clinic system in Arizona, it's a large medical system, they don't take Medicare, they can't afford it because the reimbursement is so poor. Guess what? January 1st, reimbursement from Medicare is going to go down 29%. And it's going to continue to decline so much so that at the end of the decade, Medicare reimbursement is going to be less than Medicaid reimbursement. I already care for a lot of patients who have a hard time finding an obstetrician who will care for them because the reimbursement is so poor. That's Medicaid. By the end of the decade, Medicare is going to be worse than Medicaid. We're better than this. I've never met anybody, and I certainly don't hold the belief that we didn't need health care reform. There's no question we needed health care reform. The question that we face, and the question that we face now, is what direction are we going to go? Are we going to have a big government control of health care? One size fits all, central command and control, a Soviet-style healthcare system? That's where we're headed. Or are we going to turn this around, and are we going to put those decisions back in your hands? How do we do that? We sell health insurance across state lines. For each state, we have less mandated coverage so that you decide what coverage you need. Not a bureaucrat in Springfield, or certainly not in Washington. You get real malpractice reform. Real stuff. You don't penalize states that have malpractice reform in place like Obamacare does. You treat everybody equally from a tax standpoint. You don't discriminate against people who are self-employed. And put control of health care back in the hands of patients. That's the direction we need to go. So I hope that you will remember that. Again, I'm thrilled that you're here today. I wish every chair would be full, but I'm very grateful that each one of you are here. And I hope that you talk about this. I hope that you learn more. Docs for Patient Care is D4 as in the number 4, PC.org. We have a lot of useful information on our website. I hope that you take advantage of it. And AFP has a lot on their website as well. So thank you once again for the invitation.